Wow.
Aren't they beautiful though?
Okay, my name is Dr. Chester Leathers. I'm a professor, retired. Well, I founded the Arizona Mushroom Club about 35 years ago. I held the office of president, treasurer, corresponding secretary, financier, etc. I enjoyed the study of mushrooms under the world's authority, Dr. Alexander Smith. He was filled with enthusiasm. I probably inherited some of that enthusiasm from him. I am still interested in fungi and mushrooms and hope to continue, although I'm 91. I hope to continue for another 10 years.
Every single one of these holes here is where a rodent dug up a truffle, or you know, a hypogeus fungus. A hypogeus means below ground. A hypogeus fungus and ate it. And so they eat these things, and you know, spread the spores all over. So we're just looking for that, and we're going to these places and raking back the duff. And there they are.
Look at that.
And so we can rake it back a little bit more. There's another one.
Wow.
But when you have all digs concentrated in an area like this, yes, you have a potential for a lot of truffles.
Oh, there's another one.
There's a whole nest of them.
Wow.
And then, yeah, so, you know, and also once you're done, just cover that area back up. You know, do your landscaping, replace your divots. In a few days.
So the whole process to dyeing with mushrooms can be very simple. You have to acquire the mushrooms, and then you break them up into small pieces, and you simmer them for about an hour, and that allows all of the dye molecules to extract from the fungus and just swim around into the dye liquid. And then you put your fiber in there, and then you have dyed fiber. And these mushroom dyes work best with protein-based fibers. So we're talking wool, silk, alpaca. If you want to get into mushroom dyeing, you want to look at your protein fibers for the best results.
Who are you with?
Arizona Mushroom Society.
Okay, okay.
We go on forays all over the place.
Okay.
This is a quaternarius. And quaternarius and amanita are the two most deadly of all mushrooms.
Okay.
And so... And quartz are very hard to tell, but so you want to like just learn a few simple ones and stay with those for a while.
Right.
And the safest one is this one right here.
But okay, they were in the same bag, so you probably wouldn't.
I heard quaternary.
No, it's all right. It's not that. You're gonna cook it.
Okay.
You're gonna cook it well.
Yeah.
Cook that cap and eat it. And then this is nice and fresh. You could cook that. And you could even eat the stem here, but
yeah,
just clean it up.
Okay.
Unless it's buggy, and then just cut it off.
Most people have an association with store-bought varieties and species of mushrooms. I haven't tasted anything on the shelves that I would say compares to naturally occurring mushrooms.
These are all edible, except for I don't know, these three here, I don't know if they are, but oh, this is all edible, yeah.
Oh, so this is a honey mushroom.
Yep, these are honeys, yep.
I do. Okay.
Where's your basket at? Cool.
Oh, here.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, that's the mirror there.
Yeah, we found this. This looks like cauliflower.
But this is edible. Just try a little bit of it first. Yeah, you guys did good.
You did really good.
Again, I'm an obsessive mushroom hunter, and I always have way too many mushrooms. And so I was looking for new ideas on how to use them, because even as a chef, I kind of fall back on the same ideas all the time. Another thing is that I wanted to explore. There's a lot of mushrooms that are popular in other cultures that are not popular here. Wheat lacoche is a fungus that grows on corn. Each little kernel gets filled with this fungus, and it's really kind of scary looking. And when American farmers find it, they basically tear out their crops because they think it's the end of the world. In Mexico, when they find it, they do a happy dance and they go to the market because they know that they can sell it for 10 times as much as they can sell the corn. So I thought it would be a fun one to share with you guys. The one edible that seems to be everywhere is the Aspen bolethyl ixinum. And so I made this leather with a bunch of ixinum. I want you guys to taste this. Yeah, you can pass those out now. It's actually pretty dense, and it becomes a pretty filling snack if you take it with you.
This is a hat that is made from the Amadou mushroom. I got it from a guy in Romania. There's only 8 people in the world that can make this hat. I've been coming here for about 3 years already. I'm just basically here to learn more about mushrooms and to forage and just be part of the mycophile community. In the conference room, I have basically a table that I set up at my market in Tucson, and it's got all my extracts for pain, for anxiety, for sleep, for the immune system, for nerve regeneration. All of these extracts are mostly mushroom based. My dad had 3 consecutive strokes and he had partial paralysis in his body. The doctors kind of just sent him home that way and said, you know, we can't really help him get any better. Kind of destroyed his life. He went into a depression because of that. I decided that moment that I would do something to help my dad. Upon all this research that I did, I came across a mushroom called lion's mane, and he was taking the extract that I made. After 6 months, he says, "Son, hey, I can move my fingers again." He started moving his hand. Slowly he recovered all the parts of his body that had paralysis previously. That mushroom kind of led me to other mushrooms. And that's how I got into the mushroom thing. After my dad recovered from paralysis, my grandmother said, "Hey, there's this big mushroom conference in the White Mountains. Would you like to go to that?" And I said, "Well, I've never been to anything like that, but sure." And I just came out here and I fell in love with this.